And thank you for being the driving force behind today's event. Not Arts First would not have been possible without your creativity, your resourcefulness, your drive, and your passion for the arts. So thank you for making today happen. We really appreciate it, and we're all going to have something really to enjoy over the next hour and 45 minutes. I also want to thank Kit for emceeing today for the tasty libation recipes. I'm toasting all of today's performers with my John Harvard Sour, which goes down very easily, especially at 2 p.m. here in California. So on behalf of the reunion co-chairs, I wanted to welcome you to our 8th 25th reunion virtual monthly event. I can't believe we've been doing 8 of these, but it's the 8th one. We have one more, not commencement, in May before we culminate with our actual reunion weekend on June 4, 5, and 6. So please mark your calendars and be on the lookout for much more information on the big grand finale of our 25th reunion year-long virtual celebration. One other thing I thought might be fun for us today as we scroll through the Zoom and see friendly faces of our 96 classmates. If you participated in the arts in some way while at Harvard, would you add that to your Zoom name? I'm decked out in my Harvard Glee Club white tie and tails from Keezers, which somehow barely still fits. And I added Glee Club to my Zoom name. So just click rename and add yours now. It might just be fun as we're going through the Zoom to see other things that other folks were doing while we were undergrads. So it's my pleasure today to introduce today's special guest, a star of stage and screens, plural, a winner of multiple Tony and Emmy Awards, a headliner of numerous shows. You will probably remember him from Third Rock from the Sun and Harry and the Hendersons, which is kind of our vintage during our era, to recent roles in Dexter, Perry Mason, and as Winston Churchill in The Crown. John Lithgow, class of 1967, was a member of the Harvard Board of Overseers when we arrived on campus way back in 1992, 1993. He had long been a passionate advocate for more recognition and celebration of the arts on campus. Fortunately, he had the ear of President Neil Rudenstine during the time, and John pushed hard to make that dream a reality. So in April of 1993, our freshman year, Arts First was born. Many of us here on the Zoom were participants and leaders in Arts First during those first four critical years of its existence. We got Arts First launched and off to a great start. And now, nearly 30 years later, it's still going strong as a weekend-long celebration of the performing arts and visual arts in all their forms and all their varieties at Harvard. And we can thank John Lithgow for his inspiration and vision to create Arts First in the first place. I met John Lithgow as a young freshman during an Arts First weekend. I was his so-called Sherpa during the open gala concert at Sanders Theater to help get him everywhere he needed to go, mostly on time. So when we began planning this program, and I was talking to Amory about all of her big plans for this event, I reached out to see if John would be willing to join us, and he eagerly agreed. We're so glad he did. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our special guest for today's Not Arts First festivities, John Lithgow. Take it away, John.
Hi there, my good friends. I'm John Lithgow, Harvard class of 67. Cool, huh? And you're I've 69. Been invited to greet you on the occasion of one of your non-events, the Not Arts First celebration, virtual celebration, in anticipation of your big 25th reunion. I just thought I would reminisce with you a little bit about my own history of Harvard and the arts, and Harvard and reunions. It's a wonderful thing. We're about to celebrate the 30th anniversary next year of Arts First, which began in your freshman year, all those years ago, in the spring of 1993. And a lot of you were around. In fact, we had what we called a big omnibus Friday night concert at Sanders Theater, which was kind of a celebration of the inauguration of Arts First. And of course, I was there to make speeches and welcome people. And my escort that evening was Brent Blackaby, who's one of your classmates. Brent, you're looking very, very well. Arts First has come a long way. It's been just a wonderful celebration, a big part of the Harvard year. And I think it's wonderful that you were there at the very inception, and it was the inception of your 4 years at Harvard. My 25th reunion came around, over 25 years ago. I remember that very well. And I remember the 25th reunion celebrants on that occasion. I think their class marshal was Leonard Bernstein. And I will tell you a little story, my sort of 25th anniversary, my 25th reunion story. I was the Ivy orator on class day, the day before graduation. And having heard that the 25th reunion class would be at the class day, because they had nothing else to do during those 2 hours, I decided to do a sort of evocation of their graduating year, 1941. So I collected 5 of the most popular songs of that era. I went to Widener Library and looked up all sorts of Crimson news stories of their senior year. It was 1941. It was the year during which Pearl Harbor was bombed, and they all knew that they had to prepare to go off to war. Very intense historical year. And I put on this kind of clownish, old-time newsreel comic review of the year 1941. I sang Paper Doll, and They're Either Too Young or Too Old, and I'm Stepping Out with a Memory Tonight. And it was hilarious. We all thought it was wonderful. And then we went to this sort of outdoor reception right after the ceremony, the class day activities. And I met several of these 25th reunion people. And they were incredibly moved by my comic vaudeville. They were crying and sobbing and thanking me. I even met a couple of people who were the subjects of those Crimson newspaper articles. So 25th reunions mean a lot to me. Cut forward to my own 25th reunion, and I was the class marshal at that one, duly honored. Having remembered Leonard Bernstein was his, I looked all over the place for the baton. I thought I'd saved it, but I can't find it anywhere. Sic transit gloria. But that the interesting thing is, at my own graduation, I remember thinking of the 25th reunion attendees as so very old. And then at my own 25th reunion, I looked around and I thought, well, we're all aging just fine. Now I'm a couple of years past my 50th reunion. I still feel young. And I think Harvard may have something to do with that. Mainly, I just want to give you a wonderful, not Arts First component of your reunion. I wish I were there with you. In fact, I wish Arts First was going to happen the way it always does. It's a big, crowded, fabulous outdoor event. And of course, in the COVID era, that ain't happening. My heart goes out to you, by the way, that your 25th reunion is taking place during this strange kind of invisible year. But just know that I'm with you all the way. I'm glad to be a part of your big event, such as it is. And I hope we meet, well, let's all get together at your 50th reunion. How's that?
Oh, that's awesome. Brent, thank you so much for getting in contact with John Lithgow. It's so cool to have the person who originated Arts First speak to us and reminisce about that. So let's get the show started. Classic Harvard style with the a cappella supergroup, which is led by Eric Chung. Eric, can you join me up here? I don't know how much power you have to make that happen. There we are.
Awesome. Here I am.
So, could you start off by introducing the members in this supergroup that you've assembled?
Sure. Gosh, I, I'm so glad this is on video, because if I were actually following John Lithgow, I'd be a total wreck. But that was fantastic, and thanks for pulling that together. We have a cappella supergroup. It's a must-have for a reunion. So I'm so thrilled that we could have this group together. From Collegium, we have Christine Chung, Maureen Devlin from the Din and Tonics, Ian Liston from Glee Club or Glee Club Light, in some cases both, Brent Blackaby, Scott Kerr, John Mitchell from the Notables, Deb Elitzer from the Pitches, Jen Lee Schwartz, Morgan Helmold, Rachel Skiffer from U Choir, Drew Cummings, and Rachel was part of U Choir also, and then from the Veritones, myself and Boss Codis. And I should mention, we're going to see the video soon. The videographer did something really cool where she broke out the main group in by group they sung with in college. So it's awesome. Watch for that toward the end.
Well, that's cool.
Cool. And so, Eric, now you're still, how often are you singing these days? It's been a little while since we were undergrads.
Yeah, I wish more live, but I came to Harvard as a violinist. A shout out to my fellow HRO members. I joined the Veritones, and that's what I stuck with in after college as a serious hobby. So really every year since I graduated, I've done some a cappella group or some solo work. Right now I'm singing with a great group called Similar Jones in the Boston area. And I've been there for 8 years, and one of the members is a former baritone, so that's really fun.
That's awesome. So tell us about the song y'all are performing today.
Yes, this is Still Crazy After All These Years, a great choice for a reunion by the great Paul Simon. I'm really tickled by this arrangement that we're doing this, because it's actually one I did in 1996, and we almost pulled it out for Grad Jam, which is the last hurrah for the a cappella singers. We went with a different song, which the group still actually sings to this day, which is neat. So I'm really thrilled that the group brought this arrangement to life.
Fantastic. All right, let's check it out.
Fear and
Oh my God, y'all, that was amazing. I see all the claps coming in. Let's give some love. There's no way to start the show quite like that. So thank y'all so much. Next, we're going to check out, we're going to take a little pivot here and go into a montage of some visual art. We have a lot of great stuff that people have created and shared. But first, we're going to hear from one of the artists in the montage, who's also a filmmaker and a political journalist. And beyond his many unique qualities among our classmates, he's also the only one, I believe, who's lived in a former gas station. But that's a story for another time.
This is Alan Piper.
Here is Alan Piper. Clip
with them.
Alan Piper here. The photographs I'm sharing are pictures that I've taken at Coney Island over the years. To me, Coney Island is symbolic of the American dream. It's a place where immigrants, entrepreneurs, people who felt like outsiders or maybe even freaks have been able to come and thrive for literally centuries now.
Should I pause?
Over the years, my wife and I have become close friends with the family that runs the Wonder Wheel. 2020 was supposed